I'd like to thank everybody for getting their comments up to us at this time. If you do have a comment sheet that you'd like to be brought up here, please do it right now so we can keep them moving in a really moving and organized manner. We'll start out with a statement. We've come to this time in our agenda when citizens may address the board on topics or issues that are of interest or concerns. We have received 30 requests to speak to the board. When I call your name, please receive that the VC at the table. Come up to the microphone. Speak clearly into the microphone. We did get some concerns from people who were watching this on YouTube who were unable to hear your comments. So if you want to make sure that your voice is heard, please speak clearly into the microphone. State your name, whether you're a resident of the district, and what school communities you may be affiliated with. If you're representing a particular group, please share that information. Please limit your comments to 3 minutes or less. We do have two individuals who are speaking in Spanish. There will be 6 minutes allowed for them because we're going to do that translation. Period. Please be advised the board will not engage in dialogue with members of the community during the citizen comments section. This will be your one time during the board meeting to bring your voices to the board, as we will not be accepting comments or dialogue during the board meeting itself. Comments that identify students shall be subject to Wisconsin Pupil Records Law and FERPA as student information that is not directly directory data as determined by the board. For example, the student behavior or progress record shall not be discussed at this time. This one is in Spanish. Marcelo. Marcelo de Gui.
Buenas noches a todos.
Good night, everybody.
Yo estoy aquí porque tengo mi hijo, Cassian Free, y por una compañera del lugar de donde yo vivo me di cuenta que aquí fue el año pasado a las reglas donde nosotros vivimos, según a hacer una cuenta con nosotros, con todos los que estamos ahí. Y ahí nadie se dio cuenta de esa junta. Él tomó una decisión por él.
I'm here because I have a kid in Glacier Creek, and somebody told me in my neighborhood that there was a meeting last year about this, but I didn't know anything. There were some decisions that were taken, and I was not aware of this, of the decisions that this meeting that supposedly happened last year.
Y pues no sé qué dirán los demás compañeros, pero a mí ya no estoy de acuerdo a todo esto, menos que alguien haya tomado una decisión por él mismo cuando nadie de nosotros nos dio cuenta de todo eso que está pasando.
And I'm in agreement with this decision. I don't know who was taking the decision. Maybe other people agree, but I'm completely disagreeing with this situation of my kids in school.
Y ojalá y todos me apoyen y estén de acuerdo a que no haga este cambio con nuestros hijos, porque ellos empezarían desde abajo con las escuelas.
Hopefully they agree with us because it will be hard for our kids and they will be starting from zero in their new schools.
Gracias.
Thank you.
Yes,
Corina Salazar.
Buenas tardes, mi nombre es Corina Salazar. Mi hijo va a Glacier Creek. La razón por la que estoy aquí es porque alguien supuestamente fue el año pasado a hacernos una junta a todos con Obama, es donde vivimos. Una junta a la cual yo no me di cuenta porque nadie fue, no conozco a la persona. Nunca hablé con esta supuesta persona. Hay otras personas que dicen que se han quejado que el camino de Thomas Mowen a Glacier Creek está demasiado complicado. Mentira, nadie se ha quejado. Me opongo rotundamente a que mi hijo se ha cambiado de escuela, porque cambiaría de escuela de compañeros, de maestros, y tendría que empezar de cero.
I live in my son's Glacier Creek, and I have somebody told me that there was a meeting at Dan's mobile manor, and I don't know about this meeting. Supposedly sometimes somebody came to us to talk about this. I don't know this person who went and talked with somebody. I'm in total disagreement. I don't want my kid to move from Glacier Creek to the new school with new teachers, new classmates. They'll be starting from zero. So I disagree with this decision.
Otra cosa que me parece una falta de respeto, que una persona tome una decisión sin mi consentimiento, sobre todo una decisión que va a perjudicar a mi hijo. Espero que todos ustedes lo tomen en cuenta, y si las demás personas están de acuerdo que cambien a sus hijos, que los cambien. Yo no estoy de acuerdo que cambien a mi hijo.
And I think it's a lot of lack of respect that somebody is making a decision for us with our consultation, with our agreement. If somebody agrees to have their kids moved, that's okay with them. But for me, I disagree completely that my kid is going to be moved to another school.
Y por último, si me lo permiten, me gustaría ser la persona que hizo la supuesta junta y entonces mi hermano, me gustaría por favor que pase enfrente y reconozca en mi cara y en la de mi compañera que él fue a hacernos esta supuesta junta donde todos los padres estuvimos de acuerdo. Es totalmente falso. Nadie habló con nosotros.
And I would like the person who organized this meeting, what that thing that's supposed to be happening in our neighborhood, to be there and come to the front and tell us in our faces about this meeting that supposedly happened to myself and my friend who went before me, because that never happened and we didn't know about this meeting.
Y pues, sería todo. Muchas gracias.
That would be it, and thank you very much.
Harry Brunig.
Hi, good evening. My name is Mary Brunig. I'm a former teacher here in the district. I was at the high school. Is that okay?
It will fall, sir.
Okay.
You see the twist about halfway through. Talk a lot. Very
So again, my name is Mary Brunig. I'm a former employee of the district. I retired last year as an educator here at the high school. I came here tonight not because I have a child that will be affected at all, but because I want to bring the parenting perspective, because I have a child that went through four changes in her before she was in fourth grade. She was part of a boundary redistricting in Austin, Texas, and then we had a corporate relocation and then a divorce. She was moved to four different elementary schools, and my message is children will be fine. That I've read a lot of social media posts and next door posts, and I've seen there's petitions, and I just felt like there was so much anxiety and stress by parents that I know that children are in fear. And I guess that's where my educator sensitivity came in, that I just wanted the message more so to the parents, but just to take into account that the children will be okay with the change, that change is inevitable. And I also think that it brings a resilience to children that have to make some changes. I think that the change will work out and will be as smooth as the parents that are also affected make that change. So that's one perspective I wanted to bring. The other, and I guess from an education standpoint, I've brought that up, but the other point I want to make is that I have two children, two grandchildren, at Sauk Trail Elementary. So somehow, this is all, and by the way, I mean, I'm kind of going in circles. I just wanted to say that my daughter, that went through these changes in her elementary years, then ended up at Northside to Crown into the high school, and she graduated in the top, probably top 10 in her class last year, and went to a full ride scholarship to college. I think children will be fine. The point I want to make too is that I have two grandchildren at Sauk Trail Elementary, and I felt like through this process, the negative, I've seen so much negative, and it's been mostly about Sauk Trail. And that's the part I've seen parent hysteria over, is it time out?
30 seconds, 25.
The parent hysteria over sending their children to Sauk Trail really caught me off guard, because it's a wonderful school with an amazing principal, wonderful educators. And if you take time to go and just walk the halls or talk with other parents there, they're very happy, and I think whatever is decided, that those children will make new friends. So, thank you.
Thank you. Holly Castine. You should make one sure I got your name correct.
Costin.
Costin? Okay, yeah. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Holly Costin. My husband and I have three children in the district and live in the High Point Estates neighborhood, neighborhood 69. Our family supports the option D313, and I wanted to share just a few comments I have on both family engagement and geographic criteria. It's important to understand that a substantial amount of the relationships for kids in neighborhoods 68 and 69 are established at the school, not necessarily within the neighborhood boundaries. Selecting option D313 maintains relationships developed over the years with families at school, as well as within the neighborhoods of 68 and 69. Additionally, option D313 makes the most geographic and transit sense. Since it does not bus children past Elmont, it does not add additional commute time away from families. Our children currently leave their homes by 7 a.m. to catch the school bus. Option D372 would add an additional 30 hours of commute time per year. Does putting a child on a bus for additional 30 hours for school year support Middleton's commitment to family engagement? I'd like to thank the Boundary Committee for their due diligence and objective analysis over the past several months. The committee met 13 times, reviewed nearly 300 pieces of online feedback from approximately 150 residents, and provided two community forums. After this review process, the committee objectively determined that option D313 best met the needs of the district based on the selection criteria. Finally, I'd like to thank you for your time and consideration. I look forward to hearing the discussion and what facts you use to make your final decision. Thank you.
Sarah Strell.
My name is Sarah Strell, and I live in Area 6869, and my son attends Elmont in first grade. I'm strongly advocating for D313 not only because it was the decision that the internal boundary committee came to after their hours and dollars were invested in this research, but also because there is a strong possibility that our neighborhood would be disrupted and likely have to move in middle school in the near future. By selecting D313, we could avoid the chaos of our families having to potentially move schools twice in the span of 4 years. According to the Interim Boundary Committee, a potential timeline for the district to open a third middle school at Hope Farm would be fall 2024. If this happens, areas 68 and 69 would most likely be considered to move from Farm to the new Hope Farms Middle School, given our proximity. If you move areas 68 and 69 today in the elementary boundary training, there will already be a third move since 2003. When looking at criteria 4 in the evaluation dashboard, we want to minimize the impact on students. If D313 is not chosen in the end, my first grader, Leo, will leave Elm Lawns and his school family to start at Soft Trail, though no doubt a great school, a new school, in the fall of 2020. When the new middle school were to open in 2024, he would be entering his sixth grade year. He would have attended Cromrie Middle School for 1 year. And looking at the fact of the map, it seems likely that 68 and 69 may once again move, as we are roughly 1 mile closer to Hope Farm than at Cromrie, and that's quite a bit for a student, though not insurmountable, but two school changes not of our choosing and out of our control of SPAM. This timeline is not hypothetical or in the distant future. It is well established that the size of the district is growing exponentially, and that 2024 falls well within the time frame that the Interim Boundary Committee has to create with comparative dashboards. Therefore, it's only a logical consideration that this is taken as a thread for. A good leader makes hard decisions using all the information they have at the time, of which there's quite a bit of information from the Internal Boundary Committee. I would find it a waste of the money spent on consultants and a disservice to the overall energy that was poured into the statistical analysis just to have the issue inappropriately boiled down to 2 or 3 extra minutes on a bus. According to the discussion, the extra time on a bus at the last school board meeting and driving right past the current school was a reason that the middle school option vote was being delayed. While I do hope you find value in what I say, this decision should not be about which neighborhood has the best debate team, but rather what does the data tell us. So thank you for consideration.
Nikhil Quinton.
Nikhil Quinton, and I'm a 7th grader who goes to Glacier Creek and lives in neighborhood 24. Next year, with the new proposal, I will be going to Cromrie Middle School. Today, however, I'm not asking for you to vote against this recommendation. Instead, I would like to ask that if this recommendation passes, all Glacier future 8th graders in neighborhoods 24 and 27 be grandfathered and transported to Glacier for 1 year, so that my friends and I from my neighborhood can go to Glacier for 1 year and finish middle school there. There will be no people that are adapted to that school. Going to Cromrie for 1 year will mean that we lose all of our friends from Glacier for 1 year, and we have to adapt to a new school, only to go to a new one in the next year. You might say that this would be hard to do, and that you have insufficient funding and returns, but think about this. There are two neighborhoods being shifted, 24 and 37. Combined, there are about 20 to 38 future eighth graders. Also, 24 in the past has been split between two buses, so in all there would only be about 6 to 10 extra kids on each bus. And now that there are fewer kids going to Glacier with the proposal, it would be easier to add those kids onto the less crowded buses, and would only add about approximately 5 minutes max of extra route time for the bus. Also, I've heard that 37E might even go back to Glacier, so it would be even easier to add just the 8th graders from 24. This would work because it is only for 1 year, so before the incoming 5th grade levels spike. And it is only for the 8th graders in the 2021 school year, not all 4th grades. Also, because it wouldn't require any extra buses or drivers since there are no new neighborhoods for Glacier, and they're losing 2 of the proposal, so they could easily squeeze 6 to 10 kids onto those 5 buses. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much. Jim here.
Hi, my name is Jim Aaron. I live in neighborhood 6869 with kids at both Elm Lawn and Cromrie currently. I just wanted to start out thanking the Boundary Committee, I know they took a lot of hours over their lives over the last few months to go into this issue in great detail. So I think we can all, well, we may not agree on every decision made here, we can all agree that we're appreciative of their hours. The two elementary school options that the committee has presented at the board both score well on a number of the criteria, but there are also some clear differences between the two proposals. And I'd like to ask the board that they move forward with the option that was most highly rated by the committee, option 313, D313. Six neighborhoods, numbers 7, 10, 11, 16W, 68, 69, would all be directly impacted by the decision of either D313 or the committee's second rated option, D372. In option 3D313, students in all six of these neighborhoods, if my Google Maps math is correct, would go to the closer elementary school. And in the other option, all six of those neighborhoods would go to a further elementary school than their closest option. And in fact, in some cases, neighborhoods would drive past their closest elementary school to get to their second option. In D372, all six neighborhoods would not attend the school closest to the neighborhood. In this option, neighborhoods 68 and 69 are disproportionately impacted because of the drive that has to occur. The students would be driven past Elmont, across Elmont, University Avenue to reach Sauk Trail. And on an average morning, so that's about 5 to 10 minutes to the commute. Well, that doesn't seem a lot. We're already in a part of the district that's pretty far away. And at this point, with current schedules, kids are often walking to school before sunrise and often before even twilight. That only gets worse when you add 5 to 10 more minutes to the commute times. For several weeks in the fall and winter, this means people are walking to the bus stop in the dark. If the committee's preferred option, D313, none of these six neighborhoods should require earlier bus pickup times than they do today. The second clear advantage that hasn't been stated yet today, I don't think, is building utilization. In D313, keeps Elmont, Northside, and Sauk Trail all about 40 students below their capacity through 2030. In D372, Northside comes within 10 students of its capacity by 2025 and by 6 students of its capacity by 2030. Meanwhile, Elmont will be almost 90 students below their capacity in 2030. Chair.
Thank you very much. Jackie Schwartz.
Members of the school board, thank you for taking the time to listen to community feedback. My name is Jackie Schwartz and I have two children in the district, one who attends Cromrie and the other student is at Elmont. I live in the 68 and 69 neighborhoods and I'm here tonight to voice my concern that the board is lending more weight to the loudest voices of the community and not enough weight to the data collected and the work and recommendation of the 25 members of the Boundary Borders Committee who diligently worked over the last 9 months to come up with these two plans. Community members in the 68 and 69 neighborhoods have been told that the squeaky wheel gets the grease as it relates to which neighborhood will be moved. If that is true, this process cannot be considered fair, inclusive, or in the best interest of our students and district, as more privileged neighborhoods have the privilege of being the squeakiest. Accessibility to these meetings have been limited. Neighborhoods have not been adequately notified about potential changes to their schools early enough. Childcare and transportation have not been available for these meetings, and all the meetings have taken place in the evenings during prime dinner activity and bedtime hours. It's been difficult for concerned neighbors to participate fully, especially in single parent and dual working households. It's frustrating to hear that speaking out and participating in these meetings is the best way to affect change. Throughout the Boundary redistricting process, the committee's goal has been to look at the objective data. In addition, the committee and the administration made great efforts to include the voices of the marginalized by reaching out to the neighborhoods, talking to the affected community members, hearing what they had to say, and factoring their feedback into their recommendations. At the last school board meetings, we saw the school board quickly move back several neighborhoods to their prior school when someone expressed even the slightest concern without considering the reasons why the committee placed them at that particular school to begin with. For example, during the original redistricting process, committee members from 37E expressed concerns about long bus rides to and from Sunset Ridge and Glacier Creek, and they prefer to be closer to that elementary school in Cromery Middle School. This is why 37E was deliberately moved to Northside and Cromery. Then at the last minute, a few voices expressed a desire to stay at their current school to avoid change, and they are suddenly granted that option. Why are a few voices overriding the work decisions of the committee and their considerations for the long-term benefits of the district? And as a member of the neighborhood 68-69, I'm hoping that board will truly discuss the dashboards and committee recommendations, and that tonight will share your perspectives. Thank you very much for your time and consideration.
Thank you. Elena McGee.
Good evening. Thank you for holding this session. My name is Alita McGee, and I have two sons who attend Elmont Elementary School, and I live in neighborhood 6869. I'm here tonight to talk about how these boundary changes impact transportation times for our kids. Please do not dismiss neighborhood 6869's concerns about being bused away from their closest elementary school by saying it's only 2 or 3 minutes further away. While it is true that a person traveling mid-morning in a car might be able to make the drive from Elmont to Sauk Trail, it is not realistic to expect a bus full of children that is required by law to stop at the railroad tracks between the two schools and then face two traffic lights during prime commuting hours on University to make that same drive in 2 to 3 minutes. It is also quite possible that the bus company will decide that logistically it makes more sense to have the bus take the Beltline, which would increase the travel time for our kids from 3.8 miles to 6.3 miles. It is more realistic that this trip will add no less than 5 minutes and potentially as many as 10 minutes to each commute. If we say on average that the trip adds 7 minutes each way, this adds up. This option requires our kids to spend an additional 70 minutes per week on the bus on top of the ride they already have. Over the course of the school year, this would be more than 35 hours of unnecessary bus time. In the best case scenario of 5 minutes, it's still more than 25 hours of unnecessary bus time. As a parent, I don't want to lose more than a day each year with my child to the bus. I will also point out here that option 3.7.2 also results in neighborhoods 7, 10, and 11 having their children bused past their closest elementary school, resulting in unnecessary time for those kids as well. It does not make sense in terms of student time, bus driver time, fuel costs, and environmental impact to unnecessarily bus kids past their closest elementary schools. It seems wasteful to me in terms of time and money to select an option that takes so many kids away from their closest elementary school. And for what purpose? Option 3.13 creates more equanimity and inclusivity between the schools, which honors not just the criteria set forth by the board, but also the district motto as well. As a member of neighborhood 6869, I am hoping that the board will truly consider and discuss the logistics of busing kids past their nearest school and what that really means in terms of time for the students and the resources of the district, and that they will share their perspectives on the facts publicly before the final vote is taken. Thank you for your time and consideration. We look forward to hearing your discussion and the facts you use to make this decision. Thank you.
Thank you. David Sandoval.
Hi. My name is David Sandoval. I have a son who just
just started at Monty's kindergartner, and I have a three-year-old daughter who knows where she's going to be. I live in District 1669, and I want to ask you if you're familiar with the Applewood and Prairie Hill neighborhoods in Area 68. We haven't mentioned often in these meetings yet, and we believe that's because that there are very few kiddos out there in that neighborhood, and we are essentially connected to no other neighborhoods geographically. For example, if a child from Prairie Hill wanted to get to Newberry Park, it would be approximately 2 miles and about a 40-minute walk for kids. They would walk from their neighborhood down County Road M, up Watts Road, and take a right on Highland Road. The point being is they're not really connected. So the five children that do go to Elm Lawn currently in Applewood, where I live, and the two that attend Prairie Hill are very similar to those that go to the school in Area 68. And I would say that just as important of an issue of keeping neighbors together is also keeping kids that have no neighbors geographically next to them in the same school together so they can spend time with their friends. So our bus, Bus 25, does not even go to the other areas in 68 and 69. Our kids ride a bus with kids from Lots Ridge. One way to look at it is that consultants look on a piece of paper and see neighborhoods. High Point and Newberry are mentioned regularly, but I feel Applewood and Prairie Hill could get mentioned more. And we felt inspired by the two people that spoke from Area 38 previously, and clearly it made a difference to all of you. So if the main goal is to look at students being able to maintain relationships, we would ask that our neighborhoods are looked at again as well. So there are many families that are fortunate enough to have play dates at their local park after school, and we don't have a local park just adjacently like that, and so school is kind of where that socializing happens. So thank you for your time. We actually really love all of the schools in the district and feel very fortunate to be in this district. My family just moved from Los Angeles exactly to come right here to be in this school district. And I'm really fond with all the schools here. Really the big point for me is just to keep my son, who has had a hard time adjusting, with the friends that he's adjusting to, moved away from LA because of the strife, because of the instability, and we came here and we were so excited to be in a stable place. So please keep it stable. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Lorenzo Cartier.
Good evening. This one is louder. Maybe our voice will be heard more. So good evening, my name is Rina Cloutier. I have a son at Elm Lawn, and I live in the neighborhood 68 and 69. And during the day, I work with homeowners who speaks about the school district of Middleton. So it's not about where my son goes, but I am here tonight to talk about how this boundary changes impact transportation logistics. In minimizing our concerns over the additional expense in time and money to transport our students away from their closest elementary school as just a minute or two of additional travel time, we are not only being unrealistic, we are not taking the time to fully consider the impact of these changes. Moving neighborhoods 68 and 69 away from Elm Lawn creates logistical transportation problems. Neighborhoods 68 and 69 are made up of five neighborhoods: Prairie Hill, Applewood, Newberry Heights, High Point Estates, and Valhalla Valley. High Point Estates and Valhalla Valley make up Neighborhood 69, which I am part of, and are interconnected. In fact, you cannot get to Valhalla Valley except through High Point Estates. But this is not the case for Neighborhood 68. Neighborhood 68 consists of three unique neighborhoods. Prairie Hill is approximately a mile away from Applewood, which is approximately 2 miles away by the road from Newberry Heights. Currently, students in the Applewood neighborhood share a bus with students from Fox Ridge. This was done to balance out bus commutes and so that kids would be able to get to school on time. If Neighborhood 68 is moved to Sauk Trail, it is likely that Applewood, Newberry Heights, and Prairie Hill would have to share a bus again, as they have done in the past. In the past, this has resulted in the earliest pickup times being around 6:52. If our bus ride is another 5 to 10 minutes longer, this will require our kids to be leaving home as early as 6:40 or 6:45 in order to take the bus. I hope you will consider, because it seems unreasonable to me that our children would need to be getting on a bus earlier than 7 a.m. so that neighborhood 7, 10, and 11 can bus past Sauk Trail so that they can continue to attend their preferred school. Thank you.
Thank you. Priya Manohar.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Priya. We live in the neighborhood 69, which is Taiwan Estates. I have two daughters who goes to one elementary, one is in fourth and one is in first grade. I'm here to support the option D3.13. As my younger one goes to first grade, she is very much attached to the school because she has seen her sister going to the school since at her age of 3. So she was more attached to this current school rather than the proposed one and the other option. So currently, as our kids are riding the bus to school at 7:10 in the morning, traveling around 3.8 miles every day, the new option, the other option, which was giving a proposed to school, in that one, they have to travel additionally 1 more mile, which will add some more burden, and even they have to get up early and catch the bus even more earlier than it is now. So at their younger age, I feel that this will add more challenge for them. And additionally, there are situations where we will have to go and drop them by the car. So if the boundary gets changed, we will have to travel a longer distance, go past this current school and drop them to a school even further down than the current school. This will create bottleneck situations for the traffic and the people who come to work and other stuff. Other than this, personally, in her kindergarten, during the middle of the year, the teacher got changed because of sickness. In that time itself, I could see a considerable decrease in her reading skills and math skills, so we coped up with that. But the impact has been considerable even for our teacher change. Just think of as a school change, how this in their people affect. Other than this, considering all these options and the reasons, we could have the board would choose the right option for the welfare of the kids and the community. Thanks for the time.
Thank you. Thank you. Adam E. Piazza.
Hello, Salama. My name is Adam E. Piazza. I reside in neighborhood 68. I wanted to share my appreciation with the board in regards to the amount of time each of you have put forth, not just in regards to the boundaries, but our district as a whole. We don't take your dedication to our children's education for granted. I also wanted to quickly touch base on why the boundaries committee was correct when they chose option D313. The boundaries committee took into account our district as a whole entity, not as individuals, with an emphasis on 8 criteria that laid the foundation for their choice of D313. A quick revisiting of the important criteria only adds credence to their decision. First, looking ahead to year 2025, utilizing option D372, Elm Lawn is consistently underutilized by around 18%. Option D313 allows for more efficient building utilization while also allowing neighborhoods of North Lake to attend their closest elementary schools. Furthermore, the committee put a strong emphasis on barriers to student and family engagement, with the school district committed to eliminating opportunity gaps and addressing marginalized students and their families. This is a critical factor as we look not for current individual issues, but as we look to the future through the lens of the community as a whole. As families in the district, we understand this is a daunting and arduous task. We also understand it offers an opportunity to help address students that otherwise will be affected even more. Under D313, percentage of free and reduced lunch, as well as minority students, is better balanced through all elementary schools. D372 reduces financial equanimity among schools, not aligning with the values of our district. Family engagement is also better maintained under option D313, as neighborhoods 68 and 69 are closer to their schools. In addition, neighborhoods 10, 11, and 16W attend schools that are contiguous with their surrounding neighborhoods. As representatives of our district, we ask that you vote for what is best as a community. With 25 people in over 9 months, we know that the Boundary Committee did their homework and recommended D313. Let's not waste this opportunity as a community. I ask the board to not go against the committee and vote in favor of D313. Thank you.
Thank you. There would be a pronunciation. Sintik, Rafa, and Gerald. With the rest, my apologies. If you could give your name so I can get it correctly.
That's okay. Good evening, everyone. My name is Sintik Raja Rahmanan. I'm from 69 Boundary, Hayward Estates. My son, he is going to go into a string game, and my second son is 3 years old. I'm expecting to attend to the same school. So the reason, I already have a few families and friends from the community already spoke all the points that are necessary for this group to take a decision. I'm just going to just add a little more on that. So between option D313 and 372, the D372 option for Hayward Estates is going to cost more travel time, and also it's going to reduce the sleep time for the kids. So currently, the bus time is at 7 o'clock, so probably with this new option, it's going to add 10 more minutes of earlier on commute time, and kids have to wake up accordingly. It's going to reduce the sleep time of more than 30 hours in the whole year. So sleep is really necessary for their studies and as well as health and mental growth. So along the other side, with the D372 option, so the communities which are currently is there, 7, 10, and 11, it's actually closer, this option is closer to them than High Point Estates. Also, I see that High Point Estates has faced this school change of three times in the last, 30 to 15 years. So, considering all the facts and also community barrier and sleep time and health issues for the kids, I would recommend to keep D313 for our High Point Estates and as well as our neighboring communities for their better life. And thanks for your time, and hope you hear your decision today, and along with your factors, that what facts you consider to take the decision, and absolutely, what are the decision that board books, like we accept that. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Alan Blattmeyer.
Thank you. evening, Municipal Board. I'm Ellen Plotmeyer, and my husband and I have 4 children. One just graduated, one is a junior, one is in 7th grade, and one is in 2nd grade at Elm Line. We live in neighborhood 69. It's been a privilege for us to be part of the district, and we've been very involved with each school at each level. Many others have, or will still share, the dashboard data that reflects positive benefits of option D3.1.3. I ask you to consider these statements and support this. But tonight, I'd like to briefly talk about a personal effect that a change of schools would have on my family. Our youngest daughter has significant special needs. The school environment is very anxiety-producing for her. Familiarity is integral for her to function socially and academically. For example, to help remedy this, her special ed caseworker at Elmont also works as a respite care provider for us so that our daughter can have consistency of relationship through the school year and summer. That's pretty incredible. This has helped my daughter greatly in the classroom for adjusting. I'm aware that a change of schools is difficult for all children, and that my daughter is not the only special needs child affected by the boundary changes. But I would ask that you consider the high possibility that if, or probably when, a new middle school is built, that it will likely mean another school change for my daughter. This would be 2 school boundary changes, which would be challenging for any kiddo, but particularly for mine would mean a loss in 2 academic school years while my daughter adjusted. And that's not exaggerating. It's taking 2 years at Elmont with all of the extra support. These would be 2 very difficult years for me emotionally and behaviorally, both at home and at school. I'd like to point out that for our neighborhood kids like Muriel, a school boundary change now can mean changing to a different school 4 times in 6 years. That's 4 new schools in 6 years, from Elmont to South Trail, South Trail to Cromring, Cromring to a new potential middle school, and then from middle school to high school. By keeping neighborhood 68 and 69 at their current elementary schools with option D3.1.3, it would lessen this. Please give thoughtful consideration as a potential amount of school change for neighborhoods 68 and 69 has been given a little notice. Thank you.
Thank you. Laura Knox.
Members of the school board, my name is Laura Knox. I live in the 68 and 69 neighborhoods and 2 children in the district who attend Elmont. We love Elmont, but I realize that everybody up here loves the elementary school they attend, and nobody wants to leave that school. So that aside, I do have 2 concerns tonight to voice about tonight's vote. My first concern is that the work of the 25-person committee made up of representatives from all areas of the district who have spent the last 9 months poring over data so as to put forward to the board their best recommendations is being undermined by the changing of the options based on the feedback of the loud but the few. Have all the residents of 37E and 37E been made aware of the changes that were proposed during the last meeting so that they could be here tonight to state their case? How can the board expect to repeat the work that the boundary committee so carefully completed over 9 months in just 2 meetings? Especially in a setting where board members were sitting on either end and maybe couldn't hear exactly what other board members were saying. In order to build the trust in the district and within our communities, it is vital that the board trust the committee they commissioned to do this work and base their decision on objective facts, not the loudest and most emotional voices. The boundary committee preferred D313 over D372. Do not overlook or minimize the work that they did, analyzing the numbers, percentages, and balances among all of the elementary schools. I ask you not to undermine the hours upon hours this committee worked by attempting to make big changes to appease the few and the loud. Secondly, I'm concerned about the imbalance of representation among the school board members and the affected neighborhoods. In a sense, this final decision pits neighborhoods 7, 10, 11 against 68, 69. The school board member that represents school board area 1 lives in neighborhood 7. Neighborhoods 10, 11, and 16W are represented by 4 school board members. This is a total of 5 representatives and a majority of the 9-person school board. Neighborhood 68 and 69 had 1 representative who is new to the board and is unable to be here tonight to vote, but was asked to give her opinion to the board before the discussion was complete and the new dashboards released. We trust that the board will maintain the thorough and impartial nature of the work that has been carried out to this point, and will choose the plan that is in the best interest of not just the area through which they were elected, but the Middleton district as a whole. Please consider sharing your perspectives on the facts and criteria publicly before your final vote is made tonight. Thank you for your time and consideration and for hearing all of our concerns tonight. And I do hope they are truly being heard. Thank you.
Thank you. Linaska Mosellas.
Buenas noches. Mi nombre es Linaska Morales y soy vivo en el vecindario 68-69.
I'm in Oscar Morales and I live in neighborhoods 67 and 68.
Agradezco la oportunidad que nos dan a todos los padres de escuchar nuestra preocupación esta noche.
I'm thankful for the opportunity that we have given to express our concerns to the board.
Adicional a los comentarios que han podido tener los padres que ya han hablado, quiero agregar algo.
Besides the comments that are already given to the board, I want to add something else.
Cuando tenemos hijos en casa, las familias debemos lidiar con diferentes situaciones cada día.
When we have kids at home, well, the parents we need to take into consideration certain things that happen at home.
En nuestro caso en particular, tenemos un niño con necesidad especial.
In our case, we have a kid with special needs.
Como familia, diariamente debemos luchar con cubrir las necesidades que requieren.
As a family, daily, we need to take care of the needs that he is presenting.
Actualmente está comenzando kindergarten en Pelmo. No pudo asistir al 4K porque él debía aprender cosas que los niños a su edad obviamente ya hacen, cosas simples.
Currently, he's in kindergarten in M1, and he couldn't attend 4K because he first needed to learn some other things that kids of his age at that time already knew, but he needed to learn those things outside of 4K.
Nuestra mayor preocupación como familias o como padres es cuando decidimos tener familia, mantenemos una estructura, inclusive cuando decidimos comprar una casa.
Our biggest concern as a family is that we decide to keep a structure. Even when we decide to buy a house, we want to keep a structure in our family.
Nuestra mayor preocupación es mantener para los niños la seguridad que podemos brindar. A veces los cambios deben darse. Sin embargo, en el caso de mi hijo, como quizás hay muchos otros en el distrito,
And for us, the biggest concern is that we want to keep safety for our kids. You know, changes are going to happen, things are going to happen, we want to keep that safety for our kids.
El cambio cuando comenzó en kindergarten se convirtió en un caos en la escuela y en la casa.
When he started attending the kindergarten, when he changed the kindergarten, it was chaos in our home, in school.
Actualmente, ha mejorado mucho dentro de su programa de educación especial.
Currently, he has improved a lot in his special education program at school.
Obviamente, preocupándonos que nuevamente ese cambio comience de nuevo sus alteraciones con el comportamiento, momentos para dormir.
Obviously, we are concerned that all these changes that might happen again is going to start having some trouble sleeping and some behavior problems because of the change in schools.
Pensar en el cambio de escuela, además de cambiar la estructura de cada familia.
We need to think about the changes that are going to happen, change the structure and everything. In this case, the neighborhood 68 and 69.
Estamos más lejos de las escuelas.
We are farther away from South Pole.
No estamos preocupados porque la escuela sea la mejor, otra no. Estamos seguros que todas las escuelas del distrito son buenas.
We are not worried about the school is better than the other one. We are sure that all the schools in the district are good.
Sin embargo, este cambio puede cambiar nuestra estructura familiar. Los niños deben levantarse más temprano, deben tomar el bus más temprano, regresar a casa mucho más tarde.
But these changes are going to affect our kids because they need to wake up earlier, they need to pick up the bus earlier, then they're going to have to get home later than usual.
Debemos exponer incluso a un camino más largo, pasar por la escuela donde actualmente van para asistir a una de las escuelas.
Even the commute is going to be longer and they're going to be passing through the school that already attended to go to the new school.
Adicional a esto y no menos importante, como padres responsables, este cambio de estructura afectaría no solamente nuestra estabilidad, estabilidad emocional de nuestros hijos, nuestra estructura familiar.
And as a responsible parent, we are aware that this is going to be changing our the emotional structure and what is going on inside our home.
Esto puede también causar o afectar nuestros horarios laborales.
This also is going to affect our work schedule.
O cualquier cambio que hemos tenido que realizar para cumplir con padres responsables con nuestros hijos en la escuela.
Or any changes that we might need to do just to be a responsible parent and be able to take and do all the responsibilities that we might have to do. Thank you again for this opportunity to express ourselves and all the work that you do. And hopefully the decision that you're going to make is the best for our kids.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ramasamy Singo, my apologies for not being able to pronounce your name correctly.
Good evening. My name is Ramasamy Singo. I live in High Park Estates, Area 69. My daughter is in second grade. I strongly support option B313. So the option B372 sends families in neighborhood 68 and 69. Last year, approximately 4 miles away to a subtract, which is 5 miles away from home. Having a long commute to school makes family engagement more difficult. The option B313 only affects a neighborhood that are already within the reasonable distance to subtract. The neighborhood 7, 10, and 11 are actually closer to subtract than on site. Due to the way the roads go around the catchment zone, the epicenter of neighborhood 7 is about 3.2 miles wide or 300 miles on the back of along the basin road route with an outside back car. But only about 200 mile drive to subtract, the neighborhoods 10 and 11 as a branch street, the road subtract is on before arriving across the villages by our century on the road. So I have some few examples to go over why the. So we have a middle schooler at home and she catches the bus around 7:30. For some reason, if you miss the elementary bus, then it would be really difficult for us to drop her at the school at Sakra and come back home and drop her, drop the middle schooler at the bus stop. Apart from that, like there are many other appointments when the kids are sick or not to visit, it would make it difficult for us to pick them up from the school and drop them back. It would add at least 15-20 minutes extra for each trip. So the parents in neighborhood 7 and 11 will not face these issues since they live very close to the subtract and it will not impact from their current schedule. So thanks for your time and consideration. We look forward to getting the decision and what facts you will submit to the plan decision. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Raymond. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Gabriel and I live on Pepwood Hill, neighborhood 68. I have one child in kindergarten at Elmont. The school district motto is inclusive, innovative, and inspiring. D372 simply directly counter to the inclusive part of this. Pepwood is very isolated from the rest of Middleton, kind of on our own little island, as well as other neighborhoods, and those lumped in with us in neighborhood 68, because it would be a very long walk to get to any other part of neighborhood 68 for us. That means that our connection to Middleton, as well as our children's friends, are from school. Sending our children even further away will only isolate our neighborhood further. While I identify with neighborhoods 7, 10, and 11, and potentially separating their children from others in nearby neighborhoods, their children at least have the ability to easily meet their friends via normal means. A walk from the middle of neighborhood 7 to 8, less than a mile on residential streets. This is just not an option for us in Pepwood and other areas of 68 and 69. Also, while cycle trails are arguably less convenient for those families as well, the level of inconvenience is much smaller for them compared to neighborhood 68 and 69. 7, 10, 11 have to contend with Century Avenue traffic, and 68 would have to contend with at University Avenue traffic. They're both equally bad, and that sucks. Finally, to address the kind of the elephant in the room, a quick look at the publicly available 2018 tax assessment data shows that neighborhoods 7, 10, and 11 have a total assessed value of $358 million and an average parcel value of $790,000. In comparison, 68 and 69 have a total assessed value of $169 million, or less than half that of 7, 10, and 11, and an average parcel value of $440,000, or about a little over half that of 7, 10, and 11. Which does not say that I don't feel incredibly blessed with where I do. Finally, as others have discussed or will discuss, D313 provides much more balance with free and reduced price of lunch, not percentage, as well as the students of color percentage, as compared to D372. And just want a quick reminder that almost half the students in 68 and 69 are students of color. Coupled with the fact that Sauk Trail is further away from families in 68 and 69 compared to families in 7, 10, and 11, thus reducing family engagement, D313 seems to be a superior option. Based on everything I presented, the D372 is a direct counter to the inclusive part of our school district model.
You have 30
seconds. D372 benefits of more affluent neighborhoods in Middleton at the expense of decreasing diversity and increasing barriers to student family engagement for less affluent neighborhoods, which could be construed as gerrymandering. The boundary committee spent a lot of time and came up with D313 as the number one option. I look forward to hearing your thoughts, discussion, and what facts you use to make your decision on your vote tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. Marcus Yoon.
Good evening, Middleton Cross Plains School District Board members. My name is Marcus Yoon. I live in High Point Estates, representing neighborhoods 68 and 69 in Elmont. I have three daughters, and hopefully next year they'll be able to go together to Elmont. So years ago, as an immigrant from Korea, much of my story had to do with being in the fringe. Now, as a father raising three amazing Korean American daughters, I am so grateful to be part of this school district that believes in the following words: inclusive, innovative, inspiring. These three powerful words help drive and define our mission statement and vision here in the Middleton Cross Plains School District. These words invoke a strong and incredible meaning, representing our values as good neighbors, and tell each of our students a unique story. This is our collective culture. I remind everyone of this because the simple meaning of inclusive is not excluding any section of society or any party involved in something. It is critical that inclusivity through balancing diversity in our schools is set at the highest priority when you as a school board make this bonding decision tonight. I'd like to highlight two points supported by facts to why voting for D313 is the right decision for inclusivity in our schools. First, we must strive to balance ethnic equity amongst the schools in our district. When you look at the dashboard, D313 is the best option to keep all the elementary schools in the district both racially and economically diverse. Elmont maintains its high percentage of minority students, but this option also allows Northside the opportunity to increase its ethnic diversity by 6%. In the other option, there is less balance between the schools in terms of minority students, as Almond specifically will result in a loss of diversity. How does this celebrate inclusion? Second, the socioeconomic balance amongst schools must be a priority for inclusion. As supported by the 2018 tax data, the other option focuses on those with stronger financial status, with less minority students with free reduced lunch, while the remaining neighborhoods that are less affluent are merged together. How does this celebrate inclusion? However, with option D313, the free and reduced lunch percentage remains the most balanced among all the schools. The beloved school of Sauk Trail currently has the highest level of free and reduced lunch at 41%. This can drop to 34%, reducing the gap among all the schools in the district. Now, I recognize it takes a lot of courage to be inclusive, as it accounts for all parts of society and our community, not just one. Supporting the other option does not promote inclusivity and sends a message of disregard for the ideals of our school district. Let's celebrate inclusion and vote option 313. Thank you for your time and consideration. We look forward to hearing your discussion and what facts you use to make your final decision. Thank you.
Thank you. Lynn Kramer.
Sure. Before I start, my name is Lynn Kramer and I live in the district and I have a child at Northside Elementary. Before I start, as I know the board already well knows, the difference in preference between the two options forwarded from the Internal Boundary Committee was a single vote, 39 versus 40, and the Internal Boundary Committee voted by a significant margin to send both forward. That being said, and without minimizing the large amount of hard work the Internal Boundary Committee put forward, they put forward two viable options for internal redistricting, both ultimately developed at the September 25th committee meeting. We acknowledge that all of you have studied the criteria dashboards and have pored over and listened to multiple comments from the community. For that reason, instead of reiterating what we have already presented, we would just like to take a few moments to simply highlight what we believe are the specific aspects that make D3 7.2 stand out from D3 1.33, and the most important reasons we feel that D3 7.2 is the option that makes the most sense for the district. Before I begin, I would like to point out that I am speaking on behalf of over 300 residents within and also outside the Northside catchment area who are in favor of option D3 7.2. These individuals signed a statement of support for D3 7.2 and are representative of neighborhoods 1 through 11 and beyond, including 16E, 57, and 64. As you can see from this map, which is admittedly a little hard to see, and identifies each of the 303 individuals or households who have signed a statement of support. Many of these citizens are here tonight. Please stand if you are here to support D3 7.2. The biggest and most important difference between these two plans is the impact on neighborhood unity and continuous attendance areas. To the point, option D313 creates three islands, keeping the existing island of neighborhood 68-69 and adding two new distinct islands. Neighborhood 7, which is currently contiguous with multiple neighborhoods that share a conservancy and a park, and neighborhood 10, which is connected to neighborhood 9 via multiple footpaths. On the other hand, option D372 keeps only a single existing island, neighborhoods 68 and 69, which are already isolated from surrounding communities and creates no new islands. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
My name is Siobhan Wilson. I live in neighborhood 7 North Lake. I have children in Northside and Comrie. So I want to continue where Kramer left off. As you can see from the map, neighborhoods 1 through 11 would all be affected by isolated neighborhood 7 and 10. These neighborhoods have important connections that are not affected simply by roadways. These neighborhoods have important connections, they are connected by the paths in the Pleasant Branch Conservancy, shared activities, and planned urbanized park, and various pathways between neighborhoods 9 and 10. Bike travel between these neighborhoods is common and children can. Also, bike to school safety. In fact, a number of houses in neighborhood 7 have easements in their backyard set aside for a future bike trail that will create even more integration. These valued community connections would be entirely disrupted should Plan D313 be adopted. Safety and environmental impact is another item not well accounted for by the dashboard. Wellsock Trail is a comparable distance to North Lake, Bishop's Bay, and Fox Bluff. There is the significant physical barrier of the heavily traveled Century Avenue. The current route to Northside via Balser and High Road is a small road with only one stop sign. Should the children from these neighborhoods move to Sock Trail, travel would include heavy traffic, a crowded intersection at Allen Boulevard, and four stoplights. Children would no longer be able to bike to school as travel on Century Avenue is simply not safe for an elementary aged child. Finally, congestion on Century Avenue is only becoming worse as more units are built in the new community of Bishop's Bay across from neighborhood 7 on Highway Q, which is a part of the Wanakee School District. When completed, the community will have close to 3,000 housing units, only about half of which are currently in existence. Lastly, building utilization is another important factor that must be considered. Regardless of which plan is adopted today, the school is currently populated by neighborhoods 68, 69, 7, 10, and 11, will become underutilized. However, it must be noted that Northside is located in the northeast corner of the Milton Cross Plains Area School District, where there is no future development plan. Elmont, on the other hand, is moving all closer to the area of Milton is growing. As Pope Farm student population grows and exceeds capacity as is projected by 2030, it seems logical to leave Elmont underutilized at this time, allowing for overflow from Pope Farm in the near future. For the reasons that have already been stated at the last meeting and in the last 2 weeks, but especially for the reasons highlighted just now, we strongly support option D372. I want to thank you very much for the work that you do for all of our children and for allowing us to have a voice. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Sonia Hendon.
The vast majority of responders were at least willing to meet with me to discuss PTO funding. Word even kind of spread from there that Cromrie PTO, who had not initially been part of this, asked to be invited as well. I'm really glad that so many people in the district are receptive to addressing PTO funding as a district-wide equity issue instead of something that can be solved by shuffling neighborhoods around. The Northside PTO thinks that all of the elementary schools in this district are great schools, and we proudly send our children to any of them. We want our children to be resilient, and we want them to grow and learn in communities that are socioeconomically and racially diverse. The board of Northside PTO supports option D372 because it best meets the stated criteria. It does so without singling out any specific school for a change that is unequal to changes that are happening in other elementary schools. In contrast, D313 disproportionately impacts Northside. D313 also moves the greatest number of students. I understand that people are going to be unhappy no matter what you choose tonight. And someone said earlier that a good leader does make difficult decisions. Tonight you have a difficult decision. I ask you to be brave and to be inclusive and to pick the one that truly meets the criteria, and that's D372. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And also thank you for your efforts on the PTO.
Oh.
Jen Lindar.
Good evening, everybody. I'm actually here. My kids won't be affected by this district, but I have concerns being a healthcare provider in the area with what I'm hearing. From what I remember from last year and the discussions, High Point and Alvord Park were all going to be kept together. One of the main things was to get Alvord Park out of West Middleton and in Glacier Creek. Now, because West Middleton was in a great place, they really put a lot of stuff in that, into effort. But I'm here to actually advocate for the Alvord Park neighborhood because I take care of a lot of patients who are in that area. And what I'm seeing around this whole evening is that really the squeaky wheel does get the grease. MCPASD is in a unique position to really fix a lot of the issues that we've had. This is making the ghetto 101. If you isolate Alvord Park to go to a different school than High Point, I mean, this is basic. This is basic education. I think all of our goal as educators is to put kids on a very good trajectory for the rest of their life. The law states that we need to provide an education in the least restrictive environment possible. I know it's just because I write IEPs a lot. We usually interpret that, and I know I'm going to go over, and I'm sorry, I'll go over by like 15 seconds. But we usually interpret that by in a building. I'm saying, why don't we advance, why don't we look at this in a whole district capacity? West Middleton has incorporated taxis into getting people to the school. Well, those are not available at the middle school level and at the high school level. And so I'm just saying, look at the absentee rate for people that are coming from Alvord Park. Look at the engagement rate in student conferences from parents. Parents can't get there. It's not on a bus route. This is standard sociology people. It needs to be on a bus route, even if it's not a direct bus route. There is a certain dignity in having a parent be able to get to their school. If a child misses the bus in that area, the same thing as High Point, they can't get to school. There's also a lot less school involvement in after-school activities. Also, KMS offers more than Glacier Creek for after-school activities. Again, we want to put them on the right trajectory. What I'm going to say is, take this as an example from the medical people. We changed appointments to coordinate with the bus route, and our no-show rate went from 80% no-show to 20%. This is standard community planning, people. And if you want to make a ghetto, and you want to make this part, this community, more separate, then keep them isolated. Keep them, going 12 miles away to school on a place where they can't get there.
I think we need to look at all communities. And again, the scoop the wheel gets to grease. So, thank you.
Thank you very much. Jamie Brown? Did I pronounce that correct?
Hi, I'm Jamie Brown. I'm here, I teach children in Northside Elementary, and I'm representing D372. I'm a first grader and a kindergartner, or a third grader and a kindergartner. And I, more than anything, just want to say thank you for everything that you're doing. I don't envy the decision you have to make tonight. I'm so grateful for the Boundary Committee and everything that they've done to contribute to tonight's decision. When I look at the criteria of moving to this community roughly 3 years ago, it was interesting to see all of 60 through 70, frankly, as options in our district. And when you do isolate and look at where the islands are starting, what scares me the most about the alternative in 3-3 is the fact that we're just creating more islands in a community that's already established. My kids bus past Sock Trail right now, but that doesn't change their experience. The transportation has been fine. It's the community that we've built together in that neighborhood that's allowed for it. And when you look at the criteria that's been established, keeping communities together has been the goal. I moved 6 schools in my primary education. The resiliency is kids will lose up. But this is about how you're setting the community up for the future. I fear that separating groups like 7 and 16W, separating all of that apart, is just going to drive further disparaging communities. And really, we risk losing people to private schools. We risk losing connected neighborhoods. And I don't know why we would go backwards and create more islands versus continuing and building them together. So I'm super grateful for the chance to speak, say my piece. I really echo a lot of the points made up here earlier in support of 372. I just want to say thank you for making the tough decision for all of us.
Thank you very much. Stacy Graham.
Hi everybody, I'm Stacey Graham. I live in Applewood neighborhood, which would be 68 and 69. I don't have a speech right now. I wasn't even sure if I was going to talk because everybody said everything that there is to say. But I will say that I have a son going into fourth grade next year and one going into kindergarten. So any which way you look at it, I have one that's either going to start at a new school and finish there as time goes on, or I have one that has to move and finishes last year at a different school away from his friends. Just like I do, any other neighborhood that has to move, probably there's some family with a fourth grader and a kindergartner. I've just become really like disenchanted by the whole process, because I feel like being here and watching the Boundary Committee make their recommendations and then seeing things get changed. I don't want to say so quickly, but seeing them get changed and seeing everybody get up in arms and neighborhoods against neighborhoods, and we're going to fight because they're fighting. And I just find it to be really sad, and I hope that you can take the objective information that was put together by the people that did this for months and months and use that as your primary focus to make a decision. Thank you.
Thank you. Amy Kavanaugh.
Thank you for this opportunity to address the school board. My name is Amy Kavanaugh, and I live in Newbury Heights, part of neighborhood 68 and 69. You've heard a lot of data and information to take into consideration tonight. One issue that I did want to touch on is there is a strong desire for unity in the southeast corner of the district between among neighborhood 66 to 70. And so that brings up the point that there is a strong possibility that we will be moved again when there is a new middle school. And so I would like you to take into consideration the possibility that our elementary school students may be impacted again when they are in middle school. At the last meeting, no mention of the factors that differentiate D3.13 and D3.72 were discussed. So tonight, the members of the community are eagerly anticipating a thorough and thoughtful discussion that takes into consideration all of the different facts and numbers you have been hearing based on the online feedback form, dashboards, information from the Boundary Committee, and the last two school board meetings. As you discuss, I hope you will consider the objective facts that support the geographical benefits of D313, transportation, the long-term impacts and benefits to the district as a whole. As I mentioned, the potential second boundary change in the future, the opinion of the committee, and the fact that criteria number two is the second most important factor behind enrollment. We would like you to consider the diversity and equity aspects as it applies to all the elementary schools in the district. As you've been listening to this process, I hope that the board recognizes these arguments and statements reflect a reaction to the boundary criteria and logistics versus any specific preference for a particular school over another. We know that the Middleton Cross Plains School District is a destination district, and all of the schools are outstanding. Anyone will be lucky to attend any school in the district, including and especially Sauk Trail. We understand that you have a hard job ahead of you. We truly hope that you will take into consideration all of the facts that have been presented to you tonight, not just a few or because some people are more upset or represented. Yep. This is not an easy decision, and the final decision requires the discussion and consideration of a lot of different factors. We would really like to hear each and every school member's preference and their thorough reasonings for their final choice and their vote on this important decision that affects the whole Middleton Cross Plains Area School District. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Laura Erickson.
We just moved here this summer. We're a military family. And we chose to move to Middleton after doing our research. And we chose to live in Northlake, Lake 7, because of the school, Northside. We have four children, and we have moved three times in the last 6 years. We picked Middleton since we'll be here for 3 years, as my husband was studying at the university. We wanted our family and our children to have a very stable home life for these 3 years and school life. My kids are resilient, but asking my two middle children, who will be the most affected, to switch schools next year just feels like a very big ask. And we've already moved so much. So from what I understand, option D372 would allow more of our adjacent neighborhoods to stay together. And it would also move the least amount of students. In option D372, our neighborhood 7 would be allowed to stay at Northside with our surrounding neighborhoods. Our kids have formed many friendships with our classmates in these neighborhoods. Option D313 would completely isolate neighborhood 7, and our community would suffer. So I just ask you to please support D372. And we know that no matter what, some kids will be negatively affected. So I don't know if you can consider grandfathering students in their older kids in grades where you would just allow that to be an option, that they could stay at the school they're at to allow at least one of negative change. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm coming up on the last form that I have, and that's Deborah Pickett.
Thank you. I've served on the Boundary Committee, but I'm here today only as a parent and a community member. My comments are my own. You've all been very complimentary and appreciative of the work done by the committee, and I was honored to be asked to serve on it and to have the chance to give something back to the school district that welcomed my family when we moved here 6 years ago.
It's embraced my three kids with all of the resources and opportunities that we could possibly hope for from a destination district like this one. We are all indeed very lucky to be part of this district. And while I know everyone on the Boundary Committee came with the same good intentions and the same hopes to deliver to you the best possible plan for managing our growing district's needs, we are imperfect, and we were part of an imperfect process. We were able to devote more than half a year to crafting the elementary school recommendations we have before you. That process included, as you heard, multiple presentations, massive amounts of data, analysis and feedback, two community forums, and hours upon hours of small and large group discussions. Candidly, the recommendations we've offered to you do not reflect the option that I favored most strongly, but they are the studied result of intense, thoughtful work and compromise. They truly reflect the best and most careful efforts of the group of citizens you tasked with studying this question. The single middle school recommendation you have before you, by contrast, was created and voted on from start to finish over a period of less than 2 weeks. It was discussed in detail for less than an hour. Indeed, the full group discussion lasted under 10 minutes. This is not the best we could have done. The plan to split Pope Farm students between our two middle schools while maintaining all upper elementary to middle feeder relationships as they are, keeps in place a situation that has students in the Elder Park neighborhood, the far southeast corner of our district, traveling all the way to Cross Plains to attend Glacier Creek. Here, in a state with the worst racial achievement gap in the nation, we did not take an hour to look at the circumstances that sent the district's most concentrated population of black and brown kids on the longest possible bus ride each morning. We did not hold a community meeting at the neighborhood center there to see families' input. We did not, I'm ashamed to say, even discuss as a full committee the unique burdens placed on these families by this arrangement. I urge you to look beyond the middle school recommendations as it currently stands and find a better solution.
I currently have no further sheets at this time. Is there anybody else who would like to speak to the board who has not submitted the comments? Come on, if I can see you're occupied. Thank you for coming up.
My name is Catherine Franzen, and I'm grateful to have been able to invest the time and energy in sitting on the Boundary Committee this past year. I found the task of the committee was enlightening, rewarding, and challenging because it required you to put aside your thoughts and desired outcomes for those that were best for the entire Milton community based upon carefully defined criteria. But I'm here today to speak to you not as a member of the Boundary Committee, but instead as a resident of Neighborhood 13. When I began this process, my oldest daughter was in 4K. She has since begun kindergarten at Soft Trail Elementary. I cannot tell you how incredibly happy we are for her to be a part of the school community. My daughter is challenged academically every day. She is learning a new language with surprising speed and mastery. But most importantly, she is known and cared for by every adult in the building. She is growing in her respect for all members of the community because of their differences, not in spite of them. She is learning to value unique contributions every individual makes to the Soft Trail community. She has grown by leaps and bounds since her arrival there. I urge you to consider this. Middleton is a district of neighborhood community schools, not destination schools. I would very much consider the individuals in neighborhoods 7 through 12 to be our neighbors. My girls ride their bikes regularly to visit friends in neighborhoods 7 and 8. We spend time with these neighbors at Orchard Heights Park. We take summer evening strolls through both neighborhoods. We meet to play in the conservancy, and we garden together at the Bob Community Garden.
I understand that it is very difficult to have boundaries redrawn in your neighborhood, and it is very unfortunate that there is no solution that makes a boundary that is perfectly continuous. I can empathize with the worried families feel about this transition for their children. I'm certain I will feel the same. Sometimes I think that what you don't know or what you are not familiar with can be unsettling. But I can assure you this, and that is that the Soft Trail community is absolutely wonderful and exceptionally welcoming. Occasionally, listening to community feedback hurts. While I'm certain all gestures are well-intentioned, when I hear neighbors offering to share finances in lieu of moving a community, it hurts. Because school communities are not about money. Over 20 years in the education field tells me that what makes any school successful is building and valuing and supporting a strong, inclusive community with people, not finances. And as board members, you are tasked with something very important today. The boundaries you draw leave a legacy that tells a tale of what Middleton values as a community. What a legacy to be able to leave. Thank you.
Thank you very much. At this time, one last chance to speak before the board moves out the comment section, and after that, there will be no further interaction with the board and the community. Yes, would you like to come up? And then state your name.
Yes.
Okay.
Sorry. That's really hot. I am Lindsay Snyder. I'm in Northlake, and I just want to reiterate that adjacent communities 7 and 8 share a residential street, a neighborhood park, even a yard. There are literally side-by-side neighbors that are in adjacent neighborhoods. My son rode a bus with kids from 7 and 8, but in the future these could be two different schools. So please keep this establishment and community together.
Thank you very much. Okay, at this particular point, I'm going to close the portion of the meeting for citizen feedback and then move into the regular portion of the board meeting at this time. I'm going to start by introducing the board members. Mensa Karim is not here, and I will be reading a statement from her concerning her position, but I'm not at this time. Welcome Ann Bauer, Bob Hesselbein, Katie Morgan, Paul Kenny, myself, Bob Green, Superintendent David Lowe, Annette Ashley, Sean Riley, Pat Smith, Sherry Syro, and Lori Ames. At this particular point, I'd like to ask for approval of minutes, regular minutes of December 2nd, 2019. Look for a motion to approve.
So moved. Second.
Questions or concerns? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Okay. Are there any citizen comments that have that are not to the boundary committee? Decision? Do you have a public portion? Are you interested in speaking? No? Okay. No citizen comments. Correspondence, board communication? Yes, sir.
I just wanted to mention that I attended a Chorale Music Concert at the high school, and they did an amazing job. And there were also several other concerts this week. Hats off to our music program and the new choral director. She's really putting together a nice program.
She took all my thunder, and I agree.
My daughter also performed in the winter choral concert. We were at Glacier Creek, and just echoing the same sentiment, a wonderful program, and it was wonderful to attend. Let's go.
And real quickly, I attended the student congress at high school with the sophomores. I've attended a number of years. It's a great it's just a great, it's like democracy in action, kind of like every event, except it's the Congress, and really impressed by the speeches by the kids, where the future is bright for those students.
Okay, thank you. As we're in the correspondence for communication, I think this would be the appropriate time to read the email that Mensa Dream had sent to all the board members, but I'd like to enter it in the public record by reading it out loud. Her email states, "Hi everyone, I'm writing this letter as I won't be present at the meeting on December 16th. This is also a response to several emails I received from neighborhoods 68 and 69. After much consideration of the two options presented to the board by the Boundary Committee, I have come to an opinion that I will support option D.372C, neighborhood 37E moving back to Sunset Ridge and 38 moving back to Park. I've decided this option because it makes more sense to me to keep the neighborhoods 7, 10, and 11 together, with Northside to keep the neighborhoods 16E and W together at El Juan. As far as neighborhoods 68 and 69 are concerned, moving to Sauk Trail, commuting one extra mile or adding another 2 to 3 minutes is not that bad in my opinion, while in the other option, the neighborhoods are being separated. After reviewing the options for middle school, I support neighborhoods 37E and 24 staying at Glacier and moving 70 to Cromery. Though I understand the committee didn't have enough time to review and discuss middle school options, I would like to request administration and board have one more boundary committee meeting and move the vote to January. Thank you. Everyone have a happy holiday season with your family. Mensa Kareem." Legislative. Okay.
I have no report.
All right, no report. We're moving right along. Consent agenda. I offer up for your approval of bills payable, 6.1. B, approval of resignation, which is also addendum at your desk. Approval of staff appointments, there's an addendum at your desk. As well as the district consent item approval of school safety drills. Looking for a motion?
I'll second.
Questions, concerns, any items to be pulled? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? We have no items for information discussion. Just to move this along a little bit, I'd like to make it just a very brief change in the agenda and move approval of revised calendar for 2020-2021 first, and then leave our last and remaining item, approval of boundary attendance and area plan. Does the board have an objection to that? Okay. My apologies for not letting the administration know ahead of time. If we could just a brief explanation of the approval of revised calendar for 2020-2021.
Right after the calendar was approved, when we were out at buildings, we got feedback specifically from the high school during the listening session that because of where the Common App deadline falls, which is November 1st, moving the November, or the second PD day from that first Monday in November to the previous Friday would relieve both adult and senior stress. And so that seems like a very simple change to move. It doesn't affect significantly any of the PD planning or anything else. And so we would like to recommend that we make that change.
Yeah, I would support that, and so I'd move on that we revise the calendar as the recommendation.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further questions or concerns? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Okay. Moving on to the main item at this time, approval of boundary attendance area plan. We had kind of a dizzying array of options available to us here. I'd like to make this a little bit easier for the board as well as the audience to work with at this time. And so before I get to that started, I'd like to start thanking some people before we get too involved in the emotional aspects we have here. I'd like to thank the Boundary Committee. We have many of the members here. There's a lot of time spent, a lot of information discussed. I have opinions put to the side until they can come to a decision. So I would just like to thank every member of the Boundary Committee for the effort and the time that they took to help this school district come to a decision, help the board come to a decision, help administration understand the issues that were out there. I'd like to thank Drew Howling and Mark Buffler, and my apologies to the system as well. Thank you for the job and the time that you took out of your life to help our district move forward. I'd also like to thank everybody who's here, who's also sent comments and sent feedback. Numbers are just one thing. It's easy to look at numbers, but to hear the story behind the numbers and how it impacts each individual, that certainly was very helpful as well too. There's a lot of emotion involved here as well as logic, but without the comments that were made to us, either through the feedback form, through here at time, or through phone calls and emails to us as boards, we do appreciate it. We're going to have a very difficult decision here, but in many ways, you were able to help us fill in the gap between the numbers and get a better idea of what was going on. So I'd like to thank everybody who submitted feedback. The unfortunate issue we have is we had six schools, now we're going to have seven. So there will have to be movement. But what we're trying to do is come to the best decision possible with the least amount of angst, but unfortunately there will be some people who will feel like a winner, some people feel like a loser. We have six good schools and we'll have a seven. So please keep in mind that we have good schools here and your kids will be in good schools. At this point, I'd like to start a discussion by looking at two smaller options. Right now we have Don's Mobile Manor, 37E. We have one option. Lori, if you could explain just a little bit of what we're looking at.
When we met as a group at the last board meeting, the recommendation that came from the committee was to have 37E move to Northside, and for neighborhood 38, which is currently going to Park and would have moved to Sunset Ridge, having them go back to Sunset Ridge. So based on the board had wanted to get some additional information about what the impacts would be if either of those changes were made in isolation or if those changes were both made. So in your packet, you have maps as well as a dashboard that shows the impact of moving 37E on its own, 38 on its own, as well as if both of them would be moved, what it looks like from an enrollment standpoint and what it looks like from indicators such as free or reduced lunch, English language learners, and students.
Okay, again, just to kind of make this easier with the board, I'd like to separate 37E and 38, and we'll start the discussion on 37E, either moving to Northside or remaining at Sunset. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay, I'll start the discussion just on that option. Any board members have cared to discuss this?
Right, yeah, I'm looking to. We've heard comments that the board should not amend the committee's work in any way by rejecting the changes that move either neighborhood 37 East back to Sunset Ridge or neighborhood 38 back to Park. I disagree with the sentiment, as at the meeting on November 20th, the committee did in fact want to discuss these changes, but were told that the vote had already been made. The committee was told that the board had the opportunity to raise these changes, and that is what we have done, to give a voice to those who felt like they had not been heard. These moves were originally made by the committee to try and afford these neighborhoods shorter rides to school and were perceived to be in their best interest for family engagements. In the feedback the committee and the board has received, both in public comments and online, we have heard very strongly from each of these neighborhoods that they do not feel as though it is in their best interest, and that they feel as though they will be removed from their school community and their local community if they were shifted. As a result of careful consideration, to me, it is important to move both back to their original schools. when we consider moving people, not for the numbers, not for the betterment of our district, but to try and assist them with barriers to family engagements. And we hear very loudly from those families that while the suggestion was not meant as a helpful move for them, it would actually have the opposite effect and disenfranchise 28 students and their families. We need to listen. We need to listen when we're told that our helpful suggestions are actually harmful. No other neighborhoods are being moved to help the neighborhood. All other neighborhoods are being moved for the best interests of the district as a whole, and so I would support moving those two specific neighborhoods back to the schools that they are currently attending.
All right, thank you. And just, you know, and I appreciate you have a prepared statement, but right now we will just be talking about 37, and the next vote will be on 38. Other board members?
Regarding 37, I just wanted to say that I have to give careful consideration to the options. At the last meeting, it became very clear that some of the information that we had received was not actually the sentiment of the community, which was one of the reasons why I thought that we needed to explore keeping 37 at Sunset Ridge, among other reasons, as well as, you know, the support that Sunset is able to provide currently, as we have made that a consideration when we had talked about other neighborhoods. And hearing from families directly, I think, was a real statement that we needed to take a look at this option.
Echoing some of the sentiment that has already been said, I feel that maintaining neighborhood continuity is extremely important, and I would advocate that we do go along with some of the conversations, discussions that Captain made, and maintain 370 with some separation.
Thanks. And just I share Katie's thoughts on this. I mean, neighborhood was shifted with some idea of addressing barriers for that particular neighborhood. And, you know, we've been given a lot of information, some information here that was mentioned at the last two meetings, but also other information that seemed to suggest that, you know, that's maybe wrong-headed potential change for that neighborhood. So I'd support keeping 370 at Sunset Ridge.
Okay. We're in a unique situation as we are missing one board member. So we have 8 versus 9 board members. So to make this easier as we move forward for each vote as we go through each option, I will do a roll call vote. That would make the tie easier because it is 8. And a tie. If we do come into a tie situation, I will bet at the particular point we would be at a tie, introduce a second round of discussion, and do a second round of voting. If we arrive at a tie the second time, at that point I would move it, we would remove the discussion to the next board meeting, and we'd have an odd number of 9 board members.
So, are you going to ask for a motion, Katie? You want to, since you took a little bit, you got the first comments, you want to make a motion?
Anybody can make a motion at any time. I just want to make sure the discussion was clear. Looking for a motion?
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and we have a second. Further discussion? Okay, we'll do a roll call vote.
Aye.
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 Passes unanimously. Okay, move on to 38.
Sorry.
You
expressed
your
opinion.
And any further?
I guess I'm kind of pragmatic on this, having worked on the facilities planning committee, knowing how challenging it is when we have overcrowded schools where we have the opportunity to balance it out. And I guess I have to speak against the idea of shifting it from 38 back to Park. Because I look at the red and I see in 2025, we're over 20 at Park. 419 by 2030 at Park. If we leave it as the Boundary Committee suggested, moving 38 or having it at Sunset Ridge, everything's in the green. We don't have a crowded north side. 466 is our maximum. 2025, the principal will be happy to see that there's 447 as projection. In 2030, the principal will be happy to see the projected numbers are 452 below the 466. If we're here to make sure our students have enough space to gain the most they can, and the faculty and staff have the workspace they need, we have to honor what the Boundary Committee suggested. By changing out area 37E, we're able to still comply and provide space for every student. But if we change, unfortunately, if we make that change, the neighborhood 38, once again, we're in an overcrowded situation, which is a complete contradiction of where we did our work, where we wanted to be.
The numbers that you're looking at, this one is north side, and this one is Park, so it's a different school.
Well, it's
Park. Right, but this one doesn't have it on.
Okay, but I'm still...
And in the originals, Park is out there as well. In the portion of the center.
Can you just make sure we can hear me down here? It's getting better.
Oh, sorry. Yes. Yeah. I was just trying to compare some numbers.
Okay.
We're just making sure we're all looking at the same dashboard. Yeah.
Yeah, we had a number of dashboards sent out.
But that doesn't talk about four hours.
Well,
if you look at the person. But A doesn't. Right? Because this one says that A, Park is all the same numbers as would be in 313. Period. Right.
So we're talking about the 13. Then that's only a part of the other.
Right. So it's 23 more students. Okay, I see. Sorry, I was just trying to figure out from 313, the dashboards that were sent out just showed the changes to the schools, so it was a little difficult to figure out what was correct and what was said. But thank you for clarifying.
It's very good.
Can I just my thoughts on that?
I think we're there.
I have a question, Lori. Maybe you can answer my question. Area or the number 38, neighborhood 38, is when we heard from people who live there, they talked about that it was largely rural. Is there any development that's slated for that area?
They were correct. That is an area that is more rural. I'm not aware of any developments, particularly in that neighborhood. I think where you're seeing the population growth is the community, right, you know,
the Cross Plains community
are right next to Cross Plains. So
okay.
The Park School, current Park School elementary boundaries, we will see an increase, but not necessarily because of that neighborhood.
Okay.
So I have a real hard time with 38 and figuring out exactly what the right thing to do is. I have immense respect for the comments that were made here, that they feel that Park is more consistent with the rural nature of that neighborhood, and that they object to the roof for that reason. I have really immense respect for that idea and their feelings on it. But our first criteria is utilization of buildings. And moving that neighborhood back to Park puts Park at an overcrowding situation prior to 2025. It would make it you know, it will make that school overcrowded, you know, very quickly, and that's contrary to what, you know, we're trying to achieve here. And it is the number one criteria. So I, you know, I have a real hard time scoring those two kids. I feel, you know, I feel like, you know, there's a genuine concern there about the move, but I'm concerned about, you know, changing the boundary committee's recommendation too much. You know, I really appreciate the work that the committee did. And it's hard for me. Well, I felt differently about John's whole family matter because of the reasons that were stated. I feel that this one would be sticking about the committee's recommendation. Because we are trying to make sure our schools aren't overcrowded, and that creates a problem for us. That's all.
For myself, I'm doing this a little bit differently. The last time that we met, there were a number of individuals that had spoken about maintaining continuity with Area 38, and that they really invested their families in the Cross Plains community and looking forward to that sort of reception. Outside of that, I know that speaking with some parents that they were talking that if 38 does transition, they would still look to open enroll their students in part because they want to maintain that continuity and they want their families together to see how they can view their kids into part. For me, that speaks a lot about the strength and the integrity of the maintaining the continuity of that neighborhood. And for that, recognizing that, yes, we would be over capacity by 20 students, by 8.5, I still want to recognize that the projections for this year were off and we actually dropped. So even though I do expect that we will be above that 342 projection, I can still recommend that we do need to get the data or maintain the data in the part of the school district.
Paul? I want to echo Todd's and add into it. This is one of the first hard decisions we have to make. See, and people are going to be disappointed because they understandably want to stay in the community they love, the school community they love. They want to cause the least amount of disruption for people they love more than life itself, their kids. So before any votes or anything else, I can say personally that I respect that more than I can possibly say. But we just had a referendum. We're just asking the taxpayers of our community to pay for an elementary school so we could eliminate overcrowding in our elementary schools. And before that building's even open, we're considering shifts in enrollment so that we expect one of the schools to be overcrowded in less than 5 years. And I can't support that. So I intend to vote against moving 38 back to Park.
Okay. You want to go left versus right, or maybe it should be east versus west is on the east side of the board.
So what I do is that what I'd like to make a motion to
go ahead.
To not to accept the boundary committee's recommendation in regard to the neighborhood 38, and in that situation we move to Sunset Ridge and not be in the park.
Okay, just to be clear, the motion is that 38 remain in the boundary committee's recommendation at Sunset Ridge. That's the motion?
Yes,
I'll second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Further discussion? Okay, I'll start from the east, I'll start from the west this time.
Your motion was to keep it as is and keep it as is.
Keep it, I think, well, no, they will move to Sunset Ridge.
Currently the park, yeah.
As recommended.
Yes.
I would support that.
Aye.
Aye.
Then we'll get passes. Okay. We've moved the small rocks, now we're moving to the larger rocks. Okay, at this particular time, I don't know if you could move through the where we're at now in terms of explaining the two options, 3.13 and 3.72. Oh, no worries.
So the board is down to two options. The first one being B3.1.3A. which would move neighborhood 7 and neighborhood 10 and neighborhood 11 to Sauk Trail. It would move 16 W to Mount Lawn. It would move 38 to Sunset Ridge would continue in there. And the only other changes, I believe, then would be the neighborhoods that would move to Hope Farm. So that's one option. The next option would be B3.7.2A. which would have those districts move to Hope Farm. That would move in 37, the first one, to be 3.1.3A, but instead of 7, 10, and 11 moving to Sauk Trail, 16W would be in Elm Lawn, and neighborhoods 68 and 69 would move to Sauk Trail. So the most significant differences would then be like the North Lake area versus the area down in the west side of the district in the High Point areas. And then those are your two main choices.
Okay. At this point, I'd like to hear feedback from the board this time. Somebody's ready to make a motion.
As an elected member of the Middleton Cross Plains Area School District Board, it is important to me that I share my reasoning behind the vote that I will make tonight. I attended all internal boundary committee meetings from May through November, except for one meeting which I missed for my kid's birthday. I also watched all of the recap videos for the meetings I did not attend. I watched the internal boundary committee pour over data, maps, and feedback. When it comes to the elementary school boundary recommendations, I know that these two main attendance maps before us are well considered and grounded in good research. The decision that we are making is between these two maps that were selected for board consideration by the internal boundary committee. They were selected by majority votes out of three final options. There was also a majority vote that it should be the board who makes the final determination on the best option to fulfill the needs of our district. As such, I have done due diligence to research these two options and am making my vote based on the needs of the district. Before I was elected to this position, the board voted on 8 distinct and hierarchical criteria by which the changes to boundaries should be made. It is based on these criteria that I will be selecting D3.7.2A. Number one, the projected enrollment and building utilization. Both options before us leave Park and Hope Farm over capacity by 2030 projections. Further, each option leaves us with a school underutilized in 2020. In 313, Northside will be 79 students under capacity, a drop of 57 students from this year. And in 372A, Elmore is underutilized by 85, a drop of 63 students from this year. Sunset Ridge plummets from being over capacity by 11 this year to under capacity by 118 students in both options. All other schools remain relatively stable in numbers. Essentially, both options are equal on this criterion. Number two, barriers to student and family engagement. In 3.1.3, the Northside free and reduced lunch program jumps up from 11% to 19%, while Salt Trail drops from 41%. These are significant adjustments from current enrollment. In 372, no single school has a jump of more than 4% in free and reduced lunch, and numbers remain relatively stable across the whole board. 3.7.2A achieves this criteria best. In neighborhood unity for number three, 313 causes problems for multiple neighborhoods. Seven is split from eight, and both become islands where the only neighborhood they are physically connected to attends a different school. The same is true for neighborhood 9 being split from neighborhood 10, which is the only neighborhood it touches. And again, the same is true with 16 East being split from 16 West. In essence, seven discrete islands are created where there is current unity. This would affect 188 students who live east of Pheasant Branch Conservancy and 118 students between 16 West and East, stopping over 300 students from maintaining meaningful community relationships with their neighbors would be devastating to far too many in our district. 372A wins out on this criteria. Number four, the minimizing impact on students. In 313, 19% of elementary school students would change attendance areas, with 17% of Hope Farm. 15 of 78 neighborhoods would change attendance areas. Most important to me is that seven neighborhoods would be divided from one another, which simply does not happen in 372A. In 372, 18% of elementary school students would change attendance areas, with 74% to Pope Farm. Only 13 neighborhoods would change attendance areas, and in reverting 37 East back to its original school, only 12 neighborhoods change, and 9 of those are to Pope Farm. The board's criteria states that moving a small number of students for one particular school could have a negative impact as well, and I'm pleased that we have considered moving 37 East. Therefore, 372A achieves this criteria best. Number five, fiscal responsibility. Outside of transportation costs, the logic follows that by keeping numbers similar to how they currently are, enrollment, free reduced lunch, and English language learners would enable schools to maintain their current high quality of educational opportunities. 372A does the best job of keeping the numbers relatively low to how they currently are. The elementary middle school feeder structure, with the middle school feeder structure as is, either option achieves the goal. Number seven, contiguous attendance areas. The board's criteria says, ideally, each elementary school should have one contiguous attendance area. Again, 313 fails on this criteria. Seven neighborhoods are split and attend different schools from their adjacent neighbors. In 372, two neighborhoods who currently attend school together will continue to attend school together, just at a different school. We do not create any islands in 372A. And on district transportation and efficiency, both options generally continue current route patterns, capitalize on higher speed routes for more distant travel, and set up more efficient middle school transportation. There is no significant cost increase to transportation in either option. As a result of this careful consideration, I cannot vote for 313 in any form. My vote is for 372A, and I'd like to end by thanking all of the committee and community for their engagement in this process. And I'm looking forward to getting this decision made so we can move forward in unity as an inclusive, innovative, and inspiring district.
Thank you.
So, Bob, anyone else wants to go ahead and Okay, and real briefly, Katie did a nice job of summarizing issues. I agree with much of what you said, and I support 372A as well.
I think the people at the who have taken the time to talk to us and provide us feedback are entitled to an explanation of the reasons based on the criteria. And I agree, again, with a lot of what you said, but the most important thing is the building utilization. I think both of the performance goals are relatively even on that first criteria. It's not a real signature for me, and I understand that. 313 Elm Lawn is a little less utilized, but under 372, our side is a little underutilized, so they seem to be a relatively good criteria for me. With regards to criteria number two, there's some very distinct family engagement. You know, I think this is one thing that the committee did a great job of looking at these numbers and helping us to really understand how the proposed changes will affect populations that are race, but English language learners and Greek population too. And I really think that the both proposals are relatively even on criteria number two. The criteria that really makes a difference for me as someone who's thought about this is really criteria three, and I'll talk about three and seven together. And I really do believe that 372 avoids dividing areas that may be different numbers on our sheets here that we've got, but share a lot of neighborhood aspects. There's been a lot of discussion of that today. But those neighborhoods up near North Lake are very contiguous or continuous, and I think 313 unfortunately, I can exploit that either. Sending off in neighborhoods that are right next to each other in the neighborhood elementary schools. So it's just something that I think is definitively in favor of option 317. With regard to the other criteria, creation of boundaries and minimizing campground students, I would note that 372 also would cause less students to have to choose schools. And I think that is an important consideration as well. The elementary and middle school theater structure for me wasn't a significant differentiating factor between the proposals. Middle school boundaries are something that we're going to discuss in a minute, but also something we can discuss hopefully. I can say after we build another middle school, we're a long ways away from that. But all you have to do is look at the enrollment numbers and the overcrowding of those priorities. We know that this district needs a solution there. That will be something that will have to be addressed in the future. And I don't think either of these proposals will hamstring us as we go forward. As far as the transportation efficiency, I do want to say to everybody here that we totally understand the impact on families that have to drive farther to get to the new elementary school, and in fact, have to drive past the elementary school in another day. And no way do I minimize that. I'm sure no one does. If I was in a situation, I'd probably say the exact same thing. I completely understand. I don't want to seem unsympathetic to that. But for me, the differentiating factors between the proposals really are neighborhoods that are actually right next to each other in the elementary schools. That's about minimizing the disruption and the difficulties involved in earlier mornings. I have four kids too. I understand what that means to have to get up even 7 minutes early. I can't get my kids up in enough time anyway. Another 7 minutes would be anything. So I completely understand that. Very sympathetic. But my different gym factors from here and the big stuff and keeping the neighborhoods together.
I'm sure actually got more of a question. Is there anything we can do? Sure. Is there anything we can do with bus routes, adding bus routes or something to shorten the time of the trip from area neighborhood 68, 69 to get to school? Is that at least theoretically possible?
Theoretically, that's possible. I mean, we're take on that increased cost because we would also need to make sure that we have a driver that can do it.
I wanted to, I completely echo what Katie and Todd said as well. I think as I studied the information and put together some of the things that stood out to me in making this decision, the biggest thing for me was the fact that 3.7.2A moved the fewest number of students. And I totally understand this is not an easy situation for families that this impacts. I totally understand that. This is a very tough decision. I know it puts a lot of people in a tough situation as well. But unfortunately, those are hard decisions that we have to make. I think that because it impacts the lowest number of students, that's helpful in this decision-making process. I also took a look at, in the other option, the changes that it made at a couple of the schools, particularly at Northside, and it created a situation that might need some extra resources in terms of maybe extra paras or you know, extra staffing, extra resources we might need to take a look at there. And quite honestly, just like the comment that was made that we don't want to vote on something where we're creating a situation where our buildings are going to be at capacity, I think we also want to take a look and make sure that we're not creating a situation where we're gonna need to take care of adding extra resources in order to handle those outcomes as well. The situation that we're going to be looking at the middle school level is going to be where our resources are going to need to be focused because of the number of students we're going to have in each of those middle schools. So that was a high priority for me, to create a situation where we wouldn't need to do some restructuring and things like that to handle the changes that we had made. I too, what meant a lot to me was trying to keep neighborhoods together, and where we were separating, where the proposal was separating 313, I didn't feel like that had the same impact in 3.7.2A. And I do think too, the you know, in the 313, the comment was made that, you know, the school is maybe closer to the neighborhood, given how that neighborhood commutes back and forth to that school. I don't think that is, I don't think that's accurate. I think they do go a different way than maybe the way the map shows, and I think that as a result, that also impacted my decision. So again, this is not an easy decision for us to make. This is not an easy decision for you. Listening to this, I just hope that after we have a decision, we can all feel confident that this is a great school district with great schools, and that we will all focus on how we as a district can move forward.
Thank you.
Yeah. I just wanted to say that I definitely have no prepared comments because I really came in tonight not knowing exactly what I was going to decide on this. And I want to commend the committee because I think, you know, we all had ideas of where could this land. And I think it's very a true statement to say it might not be anybody's first option, but it was really vetted and a lot of process was put into the decision. And I'm not coming into this meeting without a preconceived notion because I haven't done the research, because I have pored over every dashboard, every map, every comment I've listened to, and I've read all of the comments that have been made. I understand that these decisions are hard, and always there are going to be people that are going to disagree with the decision. I was hoping from the committee that there was going to be a clear front runner, and the fact that there wasn't means these are both viable, good options, and I am not going to come in and say, I could never, ever vote for D313. I would never vote for it. I think both of these are valid options because this committee put a lot of work into this. So I don't want to disparage anything that they did. All of our elementary schools are high quality options for our students, and I also thank the committee member for making her remarks about Sauk Trail, because I was really fearing that that was the values of Sauk Trail. I did feel like we're getting lost in the process of the comments that were being made. And being on this board, I really, it really hurt me that at some level we're pitting neighborhood against neighborhood, and that's not what we need to do. This is, for me, a big picture decision. It's not about which neighborhood has more resources or which neighborhood has a longer bus ride. I know that these are individual situations that are difficult for everyone's families. One of the things that really resonated with me is moving the least number of kids possible. I know that change is hard, and I'm hoping that, you know, when we look back at this decision down the road, it seems like there's more clarity that the kids did make it through this process, and families did make it through this process, and they're happy where they are.
Thank you.
I'm not really going to go add anything that hasn't already been spoken, but I think one of the most painful things we on the board have to face is when we look at the perimeter and the design of the district, we don't have room to put schools where we need to put schools. We shouldn't have to bus children to elementary schools only by exception. By the design of our district, that is simply not possible. And that's why I think we're all kind of hurting up here, because we're forced to make a decision between two good decisions, but a decision that none of us are going to be happy with, because I know all of us would rather see our kids walking to school or being close to their elementary school, and sadly, we simply cannot do that tonight.
I've had the pleasure of serving on the board for greater than 15 years, and I went through another boundary change in my earlier parts of the board. At that particular point in time, we did make some painful decisions, and if you look at our current map where we're at, we had lots of items. We had many neighborhoods that were being built at that time. Were bused further away from elementary school, because at that point in time there weren't people speaking out because they didn't have homes there. It was a decision that I was a part of that I felt uncomfortable with, but it was a decision that the board supported. We're now here looking at several positions where, just like Bob said, we don't have schools where the kids are at. So what we're looking at is trying to find choices which move the least amount of kids, and not only that, but create a boundary map that we can be working with for not only now, but also in the far future. Unfortunately, we do have some pockets and some islands of neighborhoods that just don't work and just don't fit. So to be quite honest, based on the other criteria that I think were spoken very well by previous board members, after considering all the other options, I am looking at 3.728 myself. Okay, questions, concerns? Looking for a motion?
So I would move an option of 3.728.
A motion?
I'll second.
I have a second. Questions, concerns, further comments? Thank you. Okay, we'll move on to the last option, middle school. This one will probably be the most difficult for many reasons. First of all, the think the lack of time that the boundary committee has to discuss the middle school option. We are basically looking at two options here. With Warren, you can spend a little time helping us to understand what we have as original often presented by the boundary committee and the option that the board has asked us to look at.
At last board meeting, as the board was listening to information about the middle school option that was presented to the board from the committee, they had asked for some additional scenarios to be looked at. And the first one was moving 37E back to Glacier Creek. And that actually will happen already based on the elementary option that was just approved, because Sunset Ridge in the middle school option that was presented would go to Glacier Creek automatically. So that scenario we don't really need to spend any time on, because that was already approved based on what we did at the elementary level. The other scenario that the board wanted to look at was in the recommendation that was presented to the board from the committee, neighborhoods 24 and 25, which are the Blackhawk neighborhoods, that instead of having both 24 and 25 go to the property, 25 currently goes to the property, 24 currently goes to Glacier. The recommendation from the committee was to have both of those community or neighborhoods go to Cromery. You had asked to see that go back to Glacier Creek 24. And then you also wanted to see at the same time if 24 went back to Glacier Creek, what it would look like if 70, which is the Elmer Park neighborhood, for that neighborhood to then go to Cromery. So that's the dashboard that you have.
We're looking at scenario one and scenario two.
Yes, you're either going to look at, well, it essentially means you're either going to go with just the Pope Farm scenario with Glacier, with John's mobile van of 37E going back to Glacier Creek, or you're going to look at scenario two, because that would incorporate 24 going back to Glacier Creek and 70 going to Cromery. So scenario one is really not an option anymore.
Okay. So let me just, my understanding from what the board was looking for an option was continuing to leave 24 at Glacier Creek and having the neighborhood 70 move to Elmer Park.
Correct.
And then the other first option, this is the original presentation from the boundary committee.
The original presentation had 24 going to Cromery and 70 remaining at Glacier Creek. The scenario, essentially scenario one, showed what would happen if that was changed and then 24 went to Glacier Creek and remained there, and instead 70 went to Cromery. But we, the board, because they've already approved the change in Dodd's mobile manner, the 37E, that you would either be staying with the scenario, the Pope Farm scenario, or you would be approving scenario two. Because scenario one did not have 37E going to Glacier Creek.
So as I understand it, the board's Pope Farm scenario, as it's on a dashboard now, is essentially the committee's recommendation, with the exception of the downfall matter that they were back in.
Correct.
And the board's Pope Farm scenario number two makes a change with regard to the 37 but would have 24 stay at issue 3
and 70 in its heart.
Correct.
And that's the decision that we want us to deviate from the bounding committee's recommendation regarding 20.7.
There's been some discussion about giving the bounding committee a little more time to talk about this specifically. Is that practical?
I think anything's possible. I think we have had some conversations about logistics and timing. So, as we've talked before, there is a lot of planning and preparation that needs to happen in order for all of these recommendations to put into place. And it affects not only the elementary school level, but middle and high school, from a sectioning and staffing perspective. And so, we're not sure if it's realistic to get the boundary committee back before the next board meeting, which is January 13th, to bring any additional information or options forward.
I understand that there were some concerns about the process. However, one thing that I did want to note is that both the elementary vote by the boundary committee was very close, and this one was not.
Correct.
But evidence is important to consider, you know, and I mean, logistically, we have asked these people for months and months of their time, and at what point are they done? Because I guess I feel like it's not for having lack of putting effort into this process. So I don't know why we wouldn't consider what the major majority of the committee did report with.
The reason I ask is because I think it's undisputed that, first of all, I want to be perfectly crystal clear. I am not second guessing the committee, nor do I want anyone to interpret anything I'm saying as an indication that I support one option over another. But there is at least a perception out there that the committee did not spend a great deal of time talking about this option. If it is feasible to get the committee back together so they can have some time to specifically address this option, even if they send us exactly what they sent us before, I'm thinking it might reassure some people out in the public that it did get the attention it deserved. Now, that's also an honest question. It may not be feasible. We may not be able to wait till the second meeting in January to have this decision. It might not be feasible to get everybody together. There might be rules or principles that we violated if we reconvened the committee after having dissolved it. I don't know. So those are all honest questions, and I'd like to hear other people's thoughts on
it. I would worry that we invalidate what they put forward by saying, well, we heard you didn't meet long enough, so back to the drawing board. I would think that could give the committee the impression that we're not satisfied with what they need forward, and that's a worry for me, too.
And since we're all talking about worries, I might as well add my worries to that as well. I would like to make another point, and it's a question. How much more are we going to gain? I don't think we have a good solution in this particular model, no matter what we do, where we will not have a shortage of space for our students. By 2020, let alone 2025, we're going to be a gap. We're going to be stuffing our middle schools until we solve that problem. How much time does the administration need lead time? We're coming up against that wall as well. Is there any way for our wonderful superintendent to give a ballpark figure of how soon, or are we already right on the cusp of having to have this decision made?
I'm looking at my colleagues who are really primarily responsible for a lot of logistics, and I know we've had many, many conversations that we are hopeful the decision will be made this evening, so that beginning over the holiday vacation, our team can start working on all of those pieces that we mentioned. If we were to postpone, it just pushes all of those decisions back. Not that that is impossible, but it will have a significant impact on our process and timelines.
I'm really struggling with the middle school within this area changes, because we have heard from more than a couple of boundary committee members that they did not feel comfortable with the time they were given. But I don't know, the time that we have, how to rectify this. So in my opinion, we are looking at changing one neighborhood in this map, because we were in the 37 East. And if this is what we have to work with, and if we give the district the best opportunity to create a cohesive plan for moving forward, then I think that this is worth approving, because also if we get a little way down the road and only one neighborhood has been moved, then others won't be so upset that there's another set of movement. If we're moving a bunch of people and then we're going to move a bunch more people, the middle schools, I don't know what the right word is, but I understand the concern that the teachers are having. And I echo the fact that it really was just one and a half meetings really where this was really fleshed out. But with that in mind, I think that probably this is the best option.
Yeah, I feel the same way. I'm very concerned about the process and the concerns from committee members and others that this wasn't adequate time to talk about them in the school. It's a terrible concern. But, there's no proposal that would fix our utilization problem in the people who are involved. And so I think we can, in our discussions tonight, we can go to see how they go, but in our discussions tonight, isolate the issues and have a good discussion. And see if we can form a consensus on the issues. But it is, it comes down to if we want to move the money order back to the relation of and move 70 over to not free. And there's pros and cons of that approach. And I think we discuss that time and we'll issue that solution.
Mr. Green?
Yes.
I move that the board approve the Pope Park scenario for middle school.
I second.
Which
the board Pope Park scenario?
The both Pope Park. Okay. The original. Okay. We have a motion and a second. Okay, comments?
Yeah, I'd like to be heard on that, and I support that as well. When we're discussing the elementary schools, I think people are entitled to an explanation of why I reached that decision. And so I'm going to take some time to explain that. It really does come down to the idea that none of these proposals are going to fix our building crime problem. And, I'm kind of a little bit of faith here that our communities can continue to be so generous and approve a future referendum for the middle school. That will be the solution. And at that time, we will have to redraw those two boundaries again, which is going to be two middle schools to three. We'll have to redraw those boundaries again. And also be able to redraw that later. So if we move any neighborhood that we move, we risk moving again as part of that process. And the whole farm scenario moves with this amount of kids at this point, if we have like minimizes that potential. I'm very troubled by the idea of overcharging this long-term conservation period. It's nothing, to the people who spoke about that and people concerned, it is not lost on any person on disability in the administration or the district. Part of that scenario, the challenge that causes. Everybody understands that. And if there was one thing that I expected to come out of this process, it was that that said they wouldn't back in the Delta Park. So I was surprised that we were considering proposal that doesn't do that. But here is my concern also. I think that we could, there are some unintended consequences of moving 70 to property. Every other kid at West Middleton
will go to Glacier Creek. So every kid, so West Middleton, the fourth graders are in fourth grade at West Middleton. Every kid in that quarter will go to Glacier Creek, the seventh kids from neighborhood seven. So those kids from neighborhood seven will go to the school the first day. And all of their classmates from West Middleton will there to get Glacier Creek. And I think that's a great unintended consequence of further creating another barrier and another problem for that neighborhood as they deal with the days. So I am very, very troubled by that. Neither is great. Neither option is great as far as creating additional barriers to that community. But given the fact that we are, I hope that we will get boundary changes again in 5 years, it is very predictable that West Middleton will end up going to Polk Farm Middle School. Very predictable, just based on geography, that elementary school will feed into a Polk Farm Middle School. So if you move suddenly in Crawford now, we may move that neighborhood again in the district in 5 years. And that's troubling to me too. So I'm really, you know, there's no perfect solution for that issue. I respect what the boundary committee did, and the point that the vote was not close is persuasive to me. And the acknowledgement that either solution is fantastic or is ideal. I support that.
I want to just mention a couple comments of my own too. I really struggle with this proposal between the two big concepts as I saw them. Access to school and eliminating those barriers so that families could be more engaged in school, or as Todd described, taking kids away from their cohorts and putting them into a new facility to create a new network. And I struggled between what was the most important thing in that kind of a situation, and I think it is more important to keep them with their cohorts. And I do think, I know that the comment was made earlier that the boundary committee did not feel like they had enough time to study this particular issue, but I do, because of the work of the boundary committee and just the diligence that they, the due diligence they put into the review process and their discussions, that even a small amount of time that they may have spent on it was very credible to me to get the kind of information back that we got. So
I'm going to probably speak with a different voice than the previous board members. One of the issues that Elbert Park has struggled with is the ability of the parents to connect with the school, especially at the middle school level. West Middleton has done a wonderful job of reaching out to the parents in a very deliberate manner and trying to reduce the barriers for transportation by the use of taxi and other alternative transportation. The largest issue that many of the parents, families, and students deal with is how to get the family involved in the education. It's not just the kids going to school, it's also the family has to be a part of that. The distance between Glacier Creek and Elbert Park is about as far as it can get in our district, basically from one side to another. There's not a bus route. There's no easy way to get there. I live in Cross Plains. When my kids are younger, what do you mean I need to drive all the way out to Cross Plains? There's very little to understand and see. You can Uber from Elbert Park. You can take a bus and do a transfer over. The ability of a parent to get to property is much easier than it is to get to Glacier Creek. We certainly need to give every family there an option to connect to the school so they can do a better job as we move these kids forward. So based on that criteria only, I am in support of moving Elbert Park out to Crawford.
I think for me, a really important factor here is the fact that if we adopt the Hope Farm scenario, we are literally splitting Polk Farm in a relatively even manner. It is so out of skew with splitting West Middleton and putting the other Blackhawk neighborhood back up to Glacier Creek. And I am incredibly uncomfortable with the fact that it is literally only the kids in a very small community that will be going to a different site. And I wanted to clarify something because there's been, I've heard this comment a few times tonight about taxis. Well, guess what? Glacier Creek has taxis too. Every day there are many taxis that are out of Glacier Creek from the need of the community. So I don't think we can discredit the fact that there are efforts made by Glacier Creek to engage in family involvement. And I think, yes, the proximity is tough, and that is not just a matter of being location for the Albert Park neighborhood. Here from the middle section of residents that go out to Fish Creek too. You know, it's the wrong direction, it's later at night. So yeah, family engagement is a challenge there in a big picture way too. But they really work very hard, having the late bus and, you know, facilitating transporting families as much as they can. So I just wanted to clarify that because I felt like tonight we were feeling that those efforts weren't made at Fisher Creek, and we certainly are.
If I can just echo that, and the work that Glacier Creek has done and Westmoreland have done in outreach to those communities has been very satisfying to see as we work with those people. One thing in my time on the board I just feel really good about is the outreach that's been made to those communities. And, the work is not nowhere near done there, and we can always do a better job. And with my view, I don't think there's ever for the next 5 years. And I think we have a middle school, we can really address this with opportunity in a comprehensive way. And that would hopefully be, frankly, better for all of our students that we've got to work
through. Due to technical difficulties, the final 4 to 5 minutes from the Monday, December 16th Board of Education meeting are not a part of this video. The board, in finishing off that meeting, voted 7-1 to approve the Pope Farm scenario for middle school boundaries starting in 2020-21, with one modification. Neighborhood 37E in the northern part of the district, just east of Highway 12, will remain at Sunset Ridge rather than going to Northside, as recommended by the Internal Attendance Boundary Committee. As a result, that means 37E will go to middle school at Glacier Creek, as they have done, rather than